Are we on?
Hey there. Hello, hello.
Hey, everybody.
Wait, as folks are joining, welcome, welcome.
It's very chilly today. Don't let the sunlight fool you.
Yep, we've got the sniffles, but we'll get through it. So, a big, big welcome to this special edition Tips from Tara video series. This is Tara Sage of TaraSageCoaching.com, devoted to helping you live your dreams and create a life and business that you don't need a vacation from. And we're so glad that you're joining us here. Welcome to all who are joining. Mm-hmm. And I'm here today with my boyfriend, Carl. Hey.
Hey, everybody.
So this is the second video of our six-part series about nomadic living.
Together with our dog Cosmo, Tara and I are living full-time in an RV, working and living from the road, exploring and traveling at our own pace, and it's been pretty good to us so far. We know a lot of people have been interested in what we're doing and have had a lot of questions. So we put together this little video series to give you guys the scoop on what we're doing and what's involved.
That's right. Yeah. So glad you're here joining us. So our first video was about why we decided to live full-time in an RV. And today we're here to share with you what we knew or thought we knew before setting out on our journey.
Yes.
So it's probably going to be a really short video, right?
Perhaps.
Because we knew so little about what the heck we were doing in terms of mechanics. Carl made a list for you guys bring it all together.
So these are things I had to look into, or together with Tara, just considering the vocabulary was quite daunting as far as weights, capacities, tongue weights, batteries, electrical systems, braking systems, brake controllers, how to use things inside the RV, a marine refrigerator, that was new to us.
Yep.
As far as the tow vehicle, the tow capacity, the weight capacity, the roof weight capacity, because we're using a roof cargo carrier.
Yep. If you're just joining, this is the list of things we had no idea about. We're just running through them quickly.
The type of engine, whether it's naturally aspirated or forced induction, apparently has a big impact on high altitude towing, which is pretty cool,
right.
I think.
So cool.
Whether or not your spare tire is full size or not, because you can't tow anything on a donut. And all kinds of, like, how to reverse the reverse steering for backing up.
Yep.
Sway control, high wind, negotiating high wind situations.
Yep.
And what else? There's a lot more.
The list is long.
It's, and electric. We're still learning. There's still stuff that's popping up that...
Yeah, hooking up the gray tank and the black tank. And you probably said all that already.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway, so we knew very, very little. All that is to make the point that we knew very, very little, but now we know those things. We've learned a tremendous amount, but we did not know that before we started. So we want to share with you a little bit about what we did know. And one of the things we knew is that we wanted a two-vehicle setup. So we want to tell you why. Just keep rambling. So part of why we wanted a two-vehicle setup is because we wanted the freedom to unhitch and go into cities and be able to park our tow vehicle. And
parallel park.
Parallel park, right. And so if you want to be able to parallel park, you don't want a big tow vehicle. So having a smaller SUV versus a pickup truck or something meant that our home that we're towing had to also be pretty small. So we went in knowing that that was going to be our setup and that we had to find the right thing to make that work. So that's one of the things we knew. What else do we know?
We definitely wanted to be mobile.
Yeah.
Obviously, we wanted to be able to travel. Tara knows more about the tiny house thing, which we also considered.
Right.
But our main priority was making sure that we could actually go places.
Yeah.
With our home.
Yeah, I looked into tiny houses. I think they're very, very cool. But one of the reasons I quickly came to understand that tiny houses weren't the right fit for us is they're actually quite heavy. And they may have wheels for zoning purposes, but they don't actually get moved very often because of their weight, and they're designed to be put in one place. And we knew that we wanted to be mobile, so we knew that an RV was the route for us.
Yeah,
so that's something we knew.
Yeah, and being able to see things like the Grand Canyon, Yellowstone, what else? We made it down to the Florida Keys.
Yeah. We knew where we wanted to go and places we wanted to
see. All these things we
want
to see and do. New Orleans, the Redwoods.
Yes. Ooh, soon. I can't wait to see that.
Yeah.
Yeah, so we also knew we didn't want to wait. We didn't want to wait for someday or later or retirement. And saw that, you know, I don't believe in someday. Someday is not a day of the week. And, you know, I teach that and coach about that. And so this was a chance, an opportunity for me and us to live that truth. So we didn't want to wait for someday, and we knew that as well. So to be clear, we were total newbies, and a little evidence of that is the first night that we slept in our RV was the first night that either one of us had ever slept in an RV in our entire life.
Yeah, we went for it. Yeah.
So again, we've learned so much, and now here we are, and we're really, really passionate about advocating for this lifestyle. You know, it started as an experiment. We were open to the possibility that it would be a short experiment and we'd return to apartment life.
Right.
But now we're making plans for a long term.
I'm actually looking into increasing the size of our battery bank and looking into solar, renewable energy.
Exciting.
Yeah, making the modifications for inverters and who knows what.
All this mechanical talk, yeah.
Stuff, yeah.
Carl knows this stuff thing.
Stuff you need to wear safety goggles for.
Okay. Well, the point is that we, you know, we see this journey now as a long-term, no end in sight plan. Mm-hmm. Like, that's how much we're loving it. And again, such an advocate for this lifestyle, and so want to help teach others how to overcome the barriers and obstacles and knowledge, know-how.
NomadicLiving101.com.
NomadicLiving101.com. Let's get right to it.
NomadicLiving101.com.
Yeah, we've got an awesome course we've put together, and want to invite you to check it out. NomadicLiving101.com has all the details about the course and the program. And it's really about for people who want to live nomadically for a month or a season or a year or forever.
That's right.
That is right. So, so you're probably wondering, and it would be a really fair question to say, okay, you guys, so you knew nothing about RVing before you started, and you had never spent a night in an RV before.
Right.
And you still decided to sell everything and move into it full time into a 20-foot home. So from day one, why? Why did we decide to do that? And that would be a really fair question.
We believed that we could improve the quality of our life.
Yeah.
In a number of ways.
It's about what we thought we knew,
yeah.
Right? Like, that's why we did it. Not because of what we knew, but because of what we thought we knew.
Yeah. The freedom to being able to pick up and go where we want, when we want, giving us an opportunity for more variety in a lot of different ways is just one.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, we thought it would give us more freedom. We thought it would give us more quality of life.
It has.
Yeah.
So far.
It has.
Yeah.
We thought it would be give us a break from monotony, too, and a no vacation needed way of living.
No vacation. Yeah, and I'll say it again. I'm working from the road, and I have vacation time that I have no urgency to use because I feel like I'm on vacation.
If that's not evidence, I don't know what is.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We also have this, I describe it as a condensed responsibilities as far as living. And it's not just because of our small space. We have so little that we're responsible for. And, you know, the fact that I can stretch on my arms and reach the bathroom and the bed. And
it's literally condensed.
And the fridge and the microwave and the dinette, you know. But we're not limited to that. You open the door and
right.
and there's the world right there.
Right.
That changes
right.
so often for us. Now.
Yeah. So what we thought we knew about that is that that kind of condensed responsibility living would bring more peace of mind and less stress and allow more time for us to reflect and to grow and to have time for creativity and to explore. And I feel like living in a smaller space has allowed for more mental space, and I'm really grateful for that.
Yeah, it's actually quite fascinating. I feel like we're living relatively large for the reduced living space that we have. I feel like our space has gotten bigger.
Right on.
In some ways. And I do not know how to describe that.
Yeah, it's pretty amazing. So these are the things we thought we knew, and these are the things that led us to dive in with both feet. And we're really thrilled to say we were right. It's nice when you're right, right? We all like to be right. But we were right about this. It's all proven to be true.
NomadicLiving101.com.
It's all proven to be true. And what else? Bonuses?
Bonuses. We really have gotten closer to each other in a lot of ways. I would say that a lot of the questions we've gotten have been, how do you stand each other in such a small space?
Yeah.
And something Tara always expresses to me, if you don't get along in a big space, it's not going to matter, you know,
how big the house is. That's right.
And I feel like we're really fortunate to have this opportunity together. And we're both learning so much about so many different things, and each other, and it's really cool.
Yeah.
It's really cool.
Yeah, so there's relationship bonuses as well.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's been our experience. So, in our course, we're going to pull back the curtain on all of this, being really transparent with you about all aspects of this lifestyle, everything from the great big long list of mechanical pieces that we're going to give you a crash course in so that you know everything you need to know to do it yourself, and also logistical pieces of this lifestyle and social pieces and personal. You know, no question's going to go unanswered. We're going to answer. If you have the gusto to ask it, we're going to make sure that question gets answered. So again, that's nomadicliving101.com. Yeah. All right. Before we go, we've got tips from Tara for today, and it's really related to this. And I want to share with you. Oh no, come back! I want to share with you a quick story, in order to use this as a teaching moment. So one time I was in Providence, Rhode Island, where I used to live and loved it. Loved Rhode Island. I was on Federal Hill, and I was walking through Federal Hill. And if you know Federal Hill is the Italian section of Providence. And a man standing next to me said, "This reminds me of Paris." And I thought, okay, well, it's Italian, not French, but all right, I'll just play along. And I was being polite, and I said, "Oh, you've been to Paris?" And he said, "No, but I've read about it." And I thought, what? Like, what? You've read about it, and you can't remember a place that you have read about if you haven't actually been there. Can I get a thumbs up? Do you hear me about this? Like, totally. You can't remember a place you haven't been to that you've just read about. You can't be reminded of a place you haven't been to. So, here's the thing, is we knew that we would never be able to confirm our theories and our suspicions about what we thought we knew about this lifestyle and what it would bring to our life unless we experienced it. We couldn't read about this and learn what we needed to know or remember the experience. We had to go and live the experience. So I'm really passionate about this, because otherwise what would have happened? We just would have wondered. We would have wondered about and held the space for someday and later and maybe at retirement. And that's not what living is about. It's about going out and doing the thing. So ultimately, it's about doing the thing that you are dreaming about, not about reading about it. You know, learn what you need to know, but then decide that you know enough to go and just do it. And trust yourself to learn what you need to learn as you do it. So that's my tip from Tara today, is decide that you know enough, or learn what you need to know, and then go and just do it, and trust you will learn the rest of what you need to know as you go. Did you and Cosmo run into any alligators on your hike in the woods yesterday? No, we did not.
No, but we ran into some people from Pennsylvania.
Pennsylvania, yeah. No alligators, just people from Pennsylvania.
People from Pennsylvania. They were very safe.
Yeah, thanks for asking, Lisa. They were very safe. So that's my tip from Tara today. And next video in our series, we are going to open the doors to our 20-foot home, which is behind us. And we're going to show you inside and out where we live and give you a sneak peek. So we're super excited about that.
NomadicLiving101.com.
NomadicLiving101.com. Check it out. Let me know if you have any questions about it. We really are here to serve and just advocates of this lifestyle, and really want to help people experience the delightfulness of it and all of the freedoms that come with it. And quality of life,
yes. I wonder if our neighbors are watching.
Anyway, much love to you all, and wishing you a life and business that you don't need a vacation from. Many blessings.
Happy travels, happy trails.
Happy trails.
Next time we'll be in...
South Carolina somewhere.
Near Charleston.
Yep. That's right. That's our plan. All right. Thanks for watching.
See ya.
Bye.
Bye.